All right, well, thank you guys for coming. To those of you at home, thank you for tuning in. My name is Tim Enriquez, and today's topic is UFOs. And I was talking with my sister-in-law the other day, shout out Heather, and I told her I was going to give this presentation. The goal is to get people kind of up to date on the topic of UFOs. And her kind of quizzical look was, has anything of significance happened in the last 5 years? She didn't really feel like, you know, she hadn't heard much. But in my opinion, actually, a fair amount has happened. And so that's really the goal, is just kind of get us a little bit up to date, hopefully spark some discussion. My goal is not to tell you what to think. It's to give you some information, and then you simply make your own decision. I've got Matthew helping me out with the PowerPoint and the tech, so hopefully that'll
Hey, Matthew.
Tech support.
Yeah. Next slide, partner. So, when we first talk about UFOs, you got to address kind of the elephant in the room, right? It's very natural that if you've grown up in the U.S. in the last 70 years, you're probably going to have a fair amount of skepticism. I know I walked around for the first 40 years of my life thinking the following. The universe is too huge. There's just no way UFOs could possibly travel any sort of distance. There's not really any good evidence for UFOs. They're always going to have some sort of natural earthly explanation. If they were really here and they're really aliens, we wouldn't be able to see them if they didn't want us to. If they wanted us to see them, they would just announce themselves. We would see it on things like the news. Tom Brokaw would be talking about it. The Washington Post would publish it on the front page. And if they were real and the government knew about it, they would tell us. Those things are certainly, next slide, totally understandable thoughts. However, to quote my brother Greg, those thoughts are no longer justifiable. All right, we have too much evidence to feel that. Next slide. This is Apollo 17, 1972. Everything in here, is, to the best of my knowledge, is real, actual photos or footage. So I mentioned it's not justifiable because UFOs are declared now as real. Let's go to this quote here. It's our first video.
Yeah, you're certainly, your timing is super good. I mean, the world is waking up in the last 2 or 3 years. I mean, whatever that means.
Richard Seven joins us to chat about some of the day's more interesting stories, and we begin with Richard's favorite topics, UFOs.
Absolutely, Erica. And, you know, gone are the days. We did a big piece on this yesterday, and I was reading the comments. Yes, I read the comments. And people were saying, hey, I'm so glad that Richard and Erica, like, treated this seriously. And, you know, I think it's important to treat it seriously. Gone are the days when we joke about it, because the U.S. military isn't joking about it. They have authenticated these videos we're looking at here, shot by U.S. Navy pilots. Objects, the U.S. military, they don't know what they are. They move at speeds that we can't move at, drop from 80,000 feet to ocean level in a second. It's been a big story. 60 Minutes did a big piece over the weekend. Anyways, weighing in on this now, former U.S. President Barack Obama. He was on the Late Show with James Corden last night, and he appeared to also confirm these videos. Take a look.
There's footage and records of objects in the skies that we don't know exactly what they are. We can't explain how they moved, their trajectory. You know, I think that we're people still take seriously trying to investigate and figure out what that is.
Erica, he added, quote, the truth is, when I came into office, I asked, is there some lab somewhere where we are keeping alien species? And he said he got the answer back from his staff, no. So he tried to find out. He said he didn't find out, but again, saying that those videos look authentic. What do you make of this, Erica?
Okay, you can stop.
I'm with the...
Not like Erica.
Can I go back?
Senator Romney's been relatively... forthcoming with about this. When he's talking about UFOs, his quote, I don't believe they're coming from foreign adversaries. If they were, that would suggest they have a technology that's in a whole different sphere than anything we understand. Frankly, China and Russia just aren't there, and neither are we. So I'm not worried about that from a national security standpoint. If for some reason they're from another system, if you will, another alien society, which I would find hard to believe, but I guess all things are possible. That would be fascinating, interesting. I know there are trillions of galaxies out there, so who knows what might have else developed. All right, so you've got relatively big people on both sides of the spectrum that are engaged and interested in this topic. Go ahead, next slide. So as of June 22, the government just came out with a report, UFOs, in other words, what we're going to talk about in the next slide, what is a UFO, but these unidentified flying objects that behave in ways that we don't understand, they're real. Okay, you cannot, that's why I said it's not justifiable, just coming out like, you know, that's just a spook. Now, clearly, if we go out and see something in the sky, 90, 95% of the time, if we don't know what it is, there is a natural earthly explanation. Okay, but the government took 144 of the most intense naval cases, and they can only explain one of them. So having their best people look at it, 143 of those cases remained unexplained. Next slide. So when we talk about UFO, what do we mean? Okay, the classic key components are that somehow it flies in a way that we don't understand. Obviously, jets have propulsion, they have wings, they have tails. Okay, they burn something and spit it out. There's no visible propulsion. Generally, it's considered to be flying against gravity. Sudden and instantaneous acceleration, so be able to move in almost any position very rapidly, much faster than anything we have. Hypersonic velocities without breaking the sound barrier. Low observability, they're hard to generally see the details on. Transmedium travel, so when you have something that doesn't have jet propulsion, it no longer has to be confined to air. So it can fly in space, it can fly in air, and it can fly underwater. There's actually a USO term, unidentified submerged objects, which is also a big issue. And these often create some psychological effects, whereas people tend to have a distinct feeling that they've seen something unusual, different than you would get just by seeing a plane that was hard to identify.
As far as the making no sound, I hadn't really ever thought about that, to be honest. You know, breaking the sound barrier. None. Is there more info on that? I mean, I guess when people are filming, they're not really able to hear, right?
Right.
But that is, if you're breaking the sound barrier, you don't hear anything. To me, that is fascinating, actually.
Right.
I never really made that connection.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't explain why that is,
right.
But that's kind of weird.
That's an interesting thing. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
And a newer term is UAP,
right.
Unidentified Aerial Phenomena.
Could it be projected holographs?
It could be. It would be unusual that you would be able to see it from so many different...
Either from us or from aliens.
Right, from so many different positions.
Sort of.
Yeah, and there's certainly going to be hypotheses out there. Right. So, how did we get here? Honestly, how did I get here? As I said, the last 4 years, I kind of walked around thinking that, you know, The X-Files was a cool show, but there's no actual evidence for any kind of UFO stuff, and we would be informed if it was. Then one of my clients, who works for a defense company, the defense company invited in Commander David Fravor, who's basically the pilot in the most famous UFO incident probably of all time, certainly of recent times, that we'll share a little bit about. And he came and talked to him, and he was blown away by the info. And I was like, wow, my client's, you know, pretty skeptical and, you know, getting paid big bucks for this. His defense company brings him in to talk about this. Could there actually be something there? And I went and listened to Fravor's podcast, and he struck me as very credible. And all of a sudden I was like, well, if he's telling the truth, is it possible then some other people that have claimed to be telling the truth? And then you start to do a little digging and you realize, wow. So let's get into the Fravor incident a little bit.
I listen to the podcast too. He seems very credible to me.
Yeah
he's incredible.
I appreciate you sharing that. So we've got in 2004, Commander David Fravor. So he was our number one Top Gun pilot. Think of the movie Tom Cruise. He's basically the Tom Cruise in real life. So he's the number one graduate of the Top Gun program, and then our current head naval instructor teaching other naval aviators what to do. So the radar on the aircraft carrier is picking up these unusual objects. As you just heard in the video, they go from 80,000 feet to above 80,000 feet of space. So that's where the radar stops. So these objects would appear 80,000 feet. They would go down to sea level in a second. To translate that, that's 105,000 miles an hour that they're traveling. And there would be up to 12 objects at once. So it wasn't just a one-time thing. And they would see them on radar for hours. So also another thing to think about is our fuel. Our best jets can fly for 30 minutes. Okay. So basically at some point the radar operator said, hey, we need to go check this out. So Fravor was out on a training exercise. He had no live weapons on his planes. And so they said, all right, we've picked this up on the radar, go to it. So he and his co-pilot fly over. They see two things. They see a very large craft submerged under the water, about the size of a Boeing 747, about 5 feet under the water. Then on top of it, as soon as they come in, that craft
submerged in deep water, but it's levitating.
It's just under the water.
Really?
So it's enough to create a surface disturbance.
That's it's in deep water. It's not laying on the ground.
No. Yeah, they're in the middle of the ocean.
Right, in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, off the California coast. Interesting.
And then on top of that is what is now known as a Tic Tac.
Right.
So it's about a 40-foot long object that he describes. Looks exactly like a Tic Tac, right? You guys know the little candy, whatever you want to call it. Okay. And so then the two planes circle this object for a while, and he describes it as just kind of bebopping back like a ping pong in a glass cup, so, you know, maneuvering back and forth. And then he decides, okay, I'm going to go investigate it. So he tells one plane to stay up top, so that plane is up high, they still have a pretty good visual. He then flies in to intercept. He locks it on radar. The thing jams his radar, so that your radar will tell you if it's being jammed. So his radar gets jammed, then the thing responds to him, kind of flies up, he starts to chase it, and then it either flies so fast it disappears or instantaneously disappears. Then it teleports, or then it goes to his rendezvous point, which they have no idea how it knew his rendezvous point. It reappeared on radar about a second later, 10 miles away. And so then this gets written up in the Times, and this happened in 2004, but it didn't get written up in the Times until 2017. So the file just kind of sat on someone's desk for about 13 years. And then it gets published. Once it's in the Times, right, the Times has a lot of credibility, people start to talk about it, and then all of a sudden other people have now come forward and said, oh, we see this too.
So this was the kind of
incident that broke everything
up. When it jumped the shark into credibility.
Right.
You got it.
Yeah. Well, that's a little background.
Okay, next slide. So let's go back. Okay.
So what's the date on this?
If you're trying to tick tock, it was on your slide, but I don't think you said it. To me, one of the most important things is all four pilots.
Oh, yes.
So report the
exact same thing, right? If this isn't one guy who said, wouldn't it be great to get a lot of attention? Mm-hmm. He also got nothing but criticism.
Of course.
I mean, they basically said, don't talk about it.
Right.
It was years and years later after he left that it became a story. But all four pilots, and they filed reports that day. Yep. They got the radar tracking that verifies it. You can see the movement and stuff on his scope. I mean,
and they've all now gone public. So right. All the pilots have gone public. They're not hidden. The radar operator has gone public.
That's the thing. I mean, because one person could just say whatever they saw. Yeah. And I think it's justifiable.
Well, you need to have a guy like this in the ultimate highest regard.
In the ranch show that Nick and I watched, the ranch out in Utah, they have had guys from the government.
Yeah, from the things come out and check it
out.
So then all of a sudden, if you start to say, okay, well, this one is credible, is there any other things that seem somewhat credible? So if we go back, basically, the modern UFO sightings began in the 1940s, essentially right after we dropped the nuclear bomb.
Right.
Okay. The most famous kind of old incident is New Mexico and Roswell. And so this is the cover of the paper, right? And so a craft crashed, and the paper reports that we recovered this craft, right? It was a flying saucer. We recovered it. The next day, then, the government steps in and says, you need to retract that story. That was a weather balloon that you recovered, not a flying saucer. Now, most of the people involved do not believe that it was. And I would suggest that if you're the first...
No details of flying disc are revealed.
Right.
Well, that's kind of an interesting thing, right?
But I would suggest that if you're going to be the first printed paper to say that you have a flying saucer, you're probably going to vet the story relatively well. But I'll leave you to decide up to that. So that's kind of initially with Roswell. You might have heard of that. Next.
Area 51.
Now, this is a memo from the FBI. Now, in fairness, this is a witness memo, so this is not an official FBI statement, but an Air Force intelligence officer reports to an FBI agent, three flying saucers have been recovered in New Mexico. They're described as being circular in shape, raised center, 50 feet in diameter. Each one was occupied by three bodies of human shape and only 3 feet tall, dressed in a metallic cloth. Each body was bandaged in a manner similar to our speed flyers. It's believed that high-powered radar caused them to crash. Okay, now I'm not saying that this is 100%, this is an accurate memo because it's released by the FBI. It's a witness memo, so they're obligated to simply write down what the witness states. So if the witness is lying, they're obligated to report that. But it's a little unusual that you would just approach the FBI with a fake story and just tell them about it. Next. One of the most famous things in the FBI, one of the most famous media things, was that in 1952, a fleet of flying saucers flies directly over the White House. I mentioned you would think that they would have been in the news. They would have told us. Well, guess what? This was the cover of the Washington Post. Flying saucer outruns pilot. Okay, tens of thousands of people saw this. 1952. This then led to the second largest press conference the U.S. has ever held, the only other one being the end of World War II. Was the biggest one.
Really?
And this now creates a turning point. What's going on is from there was no deriding of people talking about UFOs or anything like that from the 40s and 50s. There was a lot of interest. Lots of people were talking about it. The military was talking about it. But all of a sudden, they now came to a turning point where they said, look, this is kind of turning into like a frenzy. And you have to remember, too, back in the 1950s, the communication was totally different than what it is today. You didn't have cell phones. You didn't just pick up direct call. You would call. You'd speak to an operator. The operator would then plug you in. And the government feels that, you know, because remember, too, we have very tense relationships with Russia. What if they do a fake hoax, a UFO hoax, that completely destroys our communication lines because everybody's trying to call and say, I see this thing, and then they attack us. And so their attitude was, we can't get people excited about this stuff. We have got to shut this stuff down. So they created something called, next slide, Project Blue Book.
Yes.
And so the goal of Project Blue Book is to go around to any people that see UFO sightings, record the details, but then do everything you can to debunk, deride, and ridicule it so people stop coming forward. That's the official policy. It's worth mentioning that Alan Hynek, who was brought in and was a skeptic after the end of all this when he retires, he says, by the way, I flipped my mind. I now believe in UFOs as well. So even though his job was to shoot everybody down. But unfortunately, this is what created, this is basically the policy for the last 30 or 40 years This is what creates everyone feeling. I mean, right now, imagine you saw something and you were going to go tell some of your friends. You know they would tease you, right? You know the fun joke. Ah, were you on drugs? What were you doing?
Yeah.
You feel a little weird. I feel a tiny bit weird talking about it, right? And so there is a stigma. And one of my goals with this presentation is just to get rid of the stigma. We should be able to talk about this without thinking that the person's going a little psycho.
That's not anti-vaxxers,
right? A very well-publicized event was in 1966. A UFO flew over one of our nuclear silos in Montana. There are 10 independent nuclear missiles there. It shut down each one for multiple minutes. This is was written up in Military Magazine.
Really? I've never heard
Senator
of
Harry Reid talked about this in front of Congress. And so each one of those, all control. We had no control over them. And then it turned, then as it flew away, they turned back on.
Really?
Okay, next slide.
This
in 1994, a flying saucer lands outside a school in Zimbabwe. This is called the aerial event. It lands in a little patch of trees outside a school. This is not that we're trying to, you know, create any sort of prejudice or anything, but just in case you're wondering, this is a school for very high level people in Zimbabwe. You know, so like the richest elite people that are there. 64 kids, ages 6 to 12, although no adults do. It lasts about 5 minutes. Two aliens emerge from the craft and communicate telepathically with several children. Afterwards, there's depressions in the ground where the craft landed, dead plant material, unusual radioactivity on the ground, and branches broken much higher than you would think the kids could get. Now, certainly some people are going to argue, hey, look, the kids, they all kind of got together, they're pulling a prank. The most prominent psychiatrist at the time, John Mack, happened to be in Africa and made a trip then to interview them, so they took all the kids away. Those are actual drawings of the kids, individual, that they put in. There's a whole bunch. And now, this is 94, obviously these people are now adults, and we're talking about some people that are Colin's age, right? This is up to sixth grade. So of course, the first and second graders, you take with a little grain of salt, but you got someone 11, 12 years old, I think he would know if he saw a craft land and something get out and communicate with them. And to this day, they maintain that this story is true, and it's been one of the most powerful experiences ever. Next slide. In 1997, the Phoenix Light incident occurs. This is kind of its own separate thing, but thousands of people over Phoenix see this giant craft hovering over Phoenix with an unusual shape. The governor of Phoenix, a former Vietnam pilot, in other words, someone who knows a lot about flying, sees it. I know just about everything that flies. It was enormous, bigger than anything I've ever seen. It just felt otherworldly. In your gut, you could just tell it was otherworldly. Next slide.
You can talk about the Mexico.
I'm just trying to highlight a few specific things.
Yeah,
in 1999, the Cometa Report is released. The Cometa Report comes from France, and it's basically their top head of their Air Force, head of their Army, and their head of their equivalent of NASA. They get together, they analyze the UFO data, and their opinion is the extraterrestrial hypothesis is the most likely explanation for what we are seeing. This was one of the first kind of really official, not US government, but government documents that kind of puts forward this as a plausible possibility. Next slide. Let's see if we can play this. This is a video taken in 2007. Next slide. So the last image there. Yes, skip ahead.
Yeah, that last
image. I don't care, I care.
So that's the blown up of the
is
last
that head?
Image.
Oh my.
Next slide. In 2012, the UFO shuts down an airport in China.
Oh, I heard about that.
Let's go to this.
Not.
Yep.
This is our second YouTube video.
And yeah.
Just last YouTube video.
Yeah, Mexico is
the
longest
place. And thank you, Matthew, for running all this for me.
Yes, indeed. Okay. We have a tech support.
China skies forced Jiaoshan Airport to stop operations on July 7th. Outbound flights were grounded after the unidentified flying object was detected by a flight crew. The incident has captured the attention of Chinese media. Theories about the UFO's identity are burning up on the internet as well. They include everything from a hidden U.S. bomber to an elaborate man-made hoax. For now, the UFO continues to be a mystery. A spokesman from China's Civil Aviation Administration confirmed to ABC News the matter is under investigation.
The everywhere around the world is pretty hard. My heart's beating faster.
I'm gonna be all right.
So now to keep up to date, as we mentioned in 2017, right, the story kind of breaks with the news. All of a sudden, people start to get curious. It does kind of create an environment where people start to talk about it. Many of the people in Congress and Senate are interested in what particularly the military personnel have to say, and so they start to bring them in, like, so David Faber's gone in and then briefed, you know, the defense personnel and things like that, the different committees on what's going on. And they just very recently, within the last couple days, this is Christmas of 2021, a new bill sponsored by Senator Gillibrand just got signed, and it has, it definitely is the most kind of inclusive and requires the most transparency that we've seen. There's still a little bit debatable as to who's going to oversee it and, you know, exactly what their goals are going to be. But her quote is, our national security efforts rely on aerial supremacy, and these phenomena represent a challenge to our dominance over the air. Staying ahead of the UAP, remember that's the unidentified aerial phenomena, sightings is critical to keep our strategic edge and keep our nation safe. The United States needs a coordinated effort to take control and understand whether these aerial phenomena belong to a foreign government or something else altogether.
I like the part where it says a coordinated effort, because all my research shows that's the big problem.
Right, that's definitely
been nothing's bad. Ever been coordinated.
Yep. Next slide. Now, sometimes, right, the idea that it could be something else, I mean, there's lots of hypotheses. Again, I don't know the answer. I've never seen a UFO myself. I've never had any sort of interaction. But what I would kind of challenge you to think about is if it just seems like the idea that maybe it could be something else is just can't really kind of comprehend. Well, one, we believe the universe is unbelievably huge, right? And it's just so huge that it's hard to put to numbers. We believe the number of planets that can support life is likely a lot higher than we thought. A recent report that just came out, right? There are 6 billion Earth-like planets in our galaxy.
That's just an our galaxy.
Okay, 6 billion Earth-like planets. They just discovered a giant ocean on Mars.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, an actual, not a frozen ice ocean, an actual ocean right underneath the surface.
In a canyon.
In the middle of Mars.
Underwater?
Yeah, water. Yeah, actual water.
Yeah, can't, there's not underground canyon.
So I would say, you know, we're kind of stuck on our timeline, right? But think about 1,000 years from now, technology, what are we going to be able to do? Assuming we don't blow ourselves up.
Right.
10,000 years, 100,000 years, right? Well, if you take a step off, think of any of these planets. 100,000 years in terms of a planetary evolution is nothing. So all you have is another Earth, right, that happens to, let's say, a somewhat similar course of evolution, but just started a little bit before us. They could easily have technology that we don't have. And of course, there could be a lot that are behind us yet. So to me, the idea that it's just unfathomable, that doesn't make sense. Now, whether they're here, I mean, obviously, those are really interesting questions. But it, to me, it's not a crazy illogical jump for you to think that another planet out there is more evolved than we are. Now, what's going on is more interesting. Next slide.
And that there's
just skip that one. So my goal with this was, one, to educate you. You may not be aware of this, some of that information. I know I wasn't aware. When I first started to dig, I was like, well, there's actually a lot more reputable information than I would have thought out there. And so if you're like me, you might be curious about that. Hopefully to spark a little interest. I personally find the topic pretty interesting. Although admittedly, concrete, clear answers are elusive. But to me, that shouldn't discourage a search. It should just promote better searches. I would like to remove the stigma around talking about this, and that we should be able to have an intelligent discussion, right, on all sorts of different sides. And then I would challenge you to come up with your own hypothesis, and instead of a one-sentence hypothesis, and then think that through a little bit. So maybe these are our own government vehicles. That's certainly possible. But what does that mean? Maybe it is another government, Russia or China, maybe it's their vehicles. Okay, what does that mean? How long have we had? What's going on? Maybe it's something else. What would that mean? Maybe it's a hologram. Maybe it's a drone. We just don't know. But to me, it's an interesting thing to think about. And it's an interesting, we love justification systems at large when you start to think about other things that are out there that can kind of challenge those justification things, I think, in an ultimately healthy way. And then I'll just close with, I believe that's helping solve this issue may actually have some connection with some of the other big questions out there, like what happens when we die, right? How can we communicate? What's going on with our conscious? Things like that. Sometimes those answers may be intertwined. But I appreciate you guys' attention. Hope you got something out of it.
Got a lot out of it. Thanks, John.
Great job on the slides.
And there's some really good books that I've read, and Tim has also read. If you're interested,
Yeah, probably. If you just want to learn more about the UFO phenomena itself, so in other words, the best cases of UFOs that are credible, check out UFOs when governments, when generals, pilots, and government officials go on the record by Leslie Keene. If you're interested more in, people that have potentially experienced UFOs, check out John Mack. He's the Harvard psychologist who kind of devoted his life to studying
that.
Passport to the Cosmos is really good. And then there's lots of different videos and stuff.